we have more than 10 people at the audience. I think it's good, and that we can have more reaction, and that we can be divided into groups.
Oh, yes.
And Dr. Yuan. And we also have PhD students, Minhui, Guangwei, and our graduate students, most of them, and also Master Hong Xiaotai. He just graduated from Durham University.
Yeah, that's right.
He got his master's degree in philosophy. Yeah, Dr. Zhang and Dr. Tong. So we have more people today.
But how many undergraduates?
Undergraduates, no. But I think writing skills or how to write English philosophy article. Also, all of us need such a thing. So I think we are suggesting it's good. Yesterday, Professor Zhang Weil lead us consider a very, very traditional problem. A debate, the debate between skepticism and dogmatism. And Professor Zhang Weil showed maybe that debate can be considered a deeper. Using the notion of dependence, and he considered three ways to challenge dogmatism from the perspective of skeptic. That is direct challenge, a comparison, and a pure possibility. And his conclusion is, in order to be skeptic, a person must be dogmatic in a certain level, higher level, second order level, or more higher level. So, yeah, we have learned so much. And also, yesterday we heard many good questions from Dr. Yuan, Dr. Zhang, and Chen Rei, and our undergraduate student Pan Pan. So I think it's really a very fruitful lecture yesterday. And today, Professor Zhang will make a new topic. The topic is not old topic. It's, I think, old-fashioned topic. A priori knowledge. So let's welcome Professor Zhang Weil to give us the lecture.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. It's good to be back here for the third lecture. So what I'm going to do, though, is something slightly different in the beginning of this lecture. And I had this idea yesterday because I was reading this, I have my paper and having a look at it, and at the beginning of it, it's divided into, I divide the paper into three sections, and I started to think about the structure, because I often structure my papers quite carefully. So I thought I would say something initially for the undergraduates about this, about writing philosophy. So I wonder if I could say something before I start this paper about something much more general about how to go about writing philosophy. Because one thing, as a teacher, And as a writer, I'm very concerned with is the structure of what I write. It's very important that it has the structure. But the structure is connected with the content. So your paper, some writing in philosophy, which is not very good, in the analytic tradition, maybe I'm being a bit rude here to continentals, if it just goes blah, 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 like that, and it has no structure, that's no good. You need to have different parts of what you write are doing different things. So there are many parts, and the whole must fit together so that the thing functions as a whole. So think of your writing as like an animal. So an animal has flesh, right? Maybe tasty flesh if you eat the animal, but also the animal must go somewhere and maybe perform some activities. But that is no good if it has no skeleton. So you need the skeleton, is the structure of your essay, and then you can, you know, so you have the skeleton, and then you have the kind of flesh which sits over the skeleton and holds the skeleton up. So your essay must have both flesh and a skeleton if it's going to work, because your whole, but everything you write, it's not just talking about something interesting. We're going for a walk. You know, I could go for a walk out here. And I could walk around the campus and I could say, well, here we have the science building and here are many trees. And you could just say, oh, these people talked about this, and then there's this issue and then there's that issue. That's not a philosophy essay. A philosophy essay must have a function and a purpose as a whole. It's got to achieve something. It's like a functional object. So it's like this here, I mean, it's something like a coffee maker. And you're an automatic coffee maker. It is a machine with a function, and it has to make coffee. And it can do that better or worse. But in order for a coffee maker to work, I don't know which method you use for making coffee, in the hotel on campus, I put the cup in there, I press the button, and it starts grinding the coffee, then it heats up the water, and then the water drips into the coffee and then comes out in the bottom. So it has many parts. Each part does something different, but the whole, it makes me a cup of coffee. And that's very important in the morning. Without that, life has no meaning for me. So you need coffee. So you have a machine which does something, but then it has parts which are crucial for doing that thing. So the parts, they don't just, you know, like in an animal, they're not just randomly connected. You have your heart and your liver and your stomach and your muscles, and they're all connected in the right way to make you a living being. And similarly, what you write has to be like a living being in that it's got to do something. So there must be the right connection between the structure and the content. And if what you write has no structure, then that's a problem. You should be thinking, when you're writing your undergraduate essays, why is this paragraph, so here is your essay, if you like this, and these are the pages, and why is, and then you've got this passage here, well, why is this one before that one? Or why not that one before that one? There's got to be a reason for the way in which the thing is organized, which is not just random. I mean, I could go for a walk this way, I could go for a walk that way. So the whole thing must be structured in that way. Now let me explain this a bit more. What is philosophy? So it's in the analytic tradition, and which is I think of as an old tradition going back to Socrates. It's not something just in the 20th century. It's quite dialectical, but that's in a special sense of dialectical, not in the Marxist sense. It's dialectical in that it involves debate and discussion. So probably the academic subject closest to philosophy in many ways is law, strangely enough. So philosophers are kind of like lawyers. Now partly that's because we are, to some extent, we have the ability to argue for things even if we don't believe in them. So you know, lawyers quite often have to defend someone in a law court even though they think they are guilty. But they just have to, it's part of the law that you must, you know, both sides must be represented. And so philosophers have that skill as well, to argue for things they don't believe in. But of course that's very important, like in chess, when you try to think about how your opponent is arguing. So you need to be able to put yourself in the shoes of your opponent. So you always have to make your opponent as strong as possible. And then when you defeat them, it's a good victory. But we are like lawyers. So think of it this way. So you want to start off, there's some issue, or maybe you've been asked some question in an exam. I don't know if you have exams like that where you have a question which you're not expecting. Presumably it's like that for your students. So you've got this question in the exam. You should first decide what you think about it. What you think about it right now, at that point. So you should never come to the exam with a prepared answer, because that answer might not fit that question. So everything you've got to be able to think right then. And if you're writing an essay at home, you've got to be able to think for yourself. What do you think at that point about the question? So you have a view about it. And that's, so you decide that on the mind-body question, or on moral realism, or on skepticism, or on the philosophy of mathematics or science, that your view is this or that. So you know what the debate is. You've read all the things. Okay. Now here is a bad student essay. Here is a bad essay. Right. And so this one I give. Maybe I pass it, but not a good mark. So you have to read. So the professor sets you. You have to read 4 articles or 4 pieces of writing. This is Kripke. This is Davidson. This is, I don't know. This is on animal rights. This is Singer, and this is Reagan, and then this is someone who believes the opposite. A variety of readings. So here is a bad essay. Is this one? So each of these paragraphs summarizes one of these readings. Suppose there were 5 readings, 5 essays you had to read. Each of these paragraphs summarizes that, and then it concludes. Conclusion. So this is the introduction. And then you have a summary of all the readings, and then a conclusion. No. Absolutely. I would give that, I get more generous these days. I'd give 54 for that. Which is 60 is average, so. But 54 is pass, you know, if they describe everything correctly. But it's not a good essay, because each of these people is thinking of the whole topic, and then you're just running through the same things. It doesn't make any sense. So let's get rid of that.
Thank you.
So, first of all, you decide what you think. You're a materialist about the mind. You're against dualism. You think eating animals is good or bad. Right. You begin with that as your view, right? And that's where you've got to get to. So that's also going to be down the bottom. So you've got your conclusion. Or this is, it could be anything. Say your view is that pigs can fly. Suppose you think, I don't know, it could be, I mean, just, it doesn't matter. This is your view. And you've got to somehow get to that answer. But you've got, if you think, this is where the lawyer analogy comes in. If you think there's an audience or a jury who are listening to you, and you are in court, so you are addressing the jury. Do you have a jury system here?
No.
You don't have a jury system?
No.
That's a problem. So yes, you probably just have officials appointed, don't you?
Yes.
Yeah, well we have, sometimes we just make legal decisions, but sometimes if it's a murder, suppose it's a murder case, and they're trying to persuade the, they're trying to show that this person is guilty. You have 12 random people we select, and they do, and they decide if this person is innocent or guilty. And the lawyers try and persuade the jury by asking, showing evidence, and you have two lawyers on either side. And they're trying to persuade the jury. You know, imagine Socrates' trial was a bit like that. He was trying to persuade the people at the were there at his trial. So I'm a lawyer, and I'm saying, look, this person, you're on trial. I'm saying, let me persuade you all. She is guilty. She did the crime. She did the crime because you're. Now, why? What's your name? Gaia.
Yeah.
So Gaia's guilty. Right? I'm trying to argue this. And she should go to prison for a very long time. Okay. So, why?
The jury is already there in Greek, huh?
Yes. Oh. Yes. So I'm trying to persuade this. But why is she guilty?
Right.
Well, here's the first reason. Reason one. They found her fingerprints on the murder weapon. So I can show you, here is the fingerprints on the murder weapon. Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. Also, there were some witnesses who saw her going into the building very angry with the murder weapon. Now, the person on the other side, there's another lawyer on the other side, and that lawyer says, well, no, she's not guilty, she has an alibi.
Alibi, what's that?
Alibi.
The witness
said
not there.
Yes, an alibi, so she wasn't there. So there's this other reason on the other side, that the other person is, so these are reasons for the conclusion. This is critical reasoning, you probably know. These are separate reasons for the conclusion. But then, you do this critical reasoning here. But someone is saying, look, there's another reason. The other side is saying, look, this shows that she's not guilty. So I have to get rid of this reason. I have to show, actually, but that was just her mother. And of course, her mother would say that. Mm-hmm. And can you trust her mother? So the third point there is, the third issue has to be, my four is that this one, this negative point is no good. So then I say, look, there's these two reasons, fingerprints, this person saw her. Now the opposing side say there was alibi, but that alibi is no good, therefore she is guilty. And a lot of philosophy is not entirely different. You're a materialist, right? Well, what are the reasons to be a materialist? Well, it seems that mind and body causally interact. So that's a reason in its favour. But what about consciousness? Problem. Can it be explained? And then you say, well, actually, the reasons in favour of saying that consciousness is against materialism, they're not good. Therefore, materialism is true. So it's like, so philosophy in this way, it's like law, it's also like martial art. So philosophy, apparently Socrates, before he went into philosophy quite late in his life, because I know this from an ancient Greek scholar, a friend of mine, and he used to be a military man. And a lot of the way we talk about philosophy is slightly like military. Quite often it's like this. It's like a fight. You've got to show something. I don't know if people do. I don't do martial arts or fighting, but it's a bit like. Do you mind? Could you just stand here for a moment? Sorry. Sorry, I know I'm embarrassing you, but it's okay. So we are opposing each other philosophically, right? So I'm trying to prove my this, but she's also trying to show the opposite, right? So you must always imagine the opposite view, because very intelligent people in philosophy think the other side from you. So here we are, okay. Right. Okay. So here's my reason. So I'm trying to sort of knock her out, and she's trying to knock me out. She's probably done martial arts. Yes. I could have a reason like this. I could say it could go like this. I have a reason. She has an argument against, but I have an argument against her reason. So this would go like this. So I'm here, and I'm trying to land a dialectical blow. So I go like this. Now if you block it. So you put your hand up like that, like block. Okay. So my argument is like this, but then I can do this.
Yeah. So
you can still do that. So then in that case, you do that.
Yeah.
So then this is all my argument against you, but then you've got your argument, so then you're going to argue against me, and then I go block, and then so I've got rid of that. So thank you very much. Thank you.
Yeah.
That's very good. But notice something that was happening there. Say you're arguing for God's existence, right?
Mm-hmm.
You've got arguments for God's existence and arguments against God's existence. But notice that an argument against an argument for something is not the same as an argument for the opposite. Okay, this is really important that undergraduates understand this. So suppose I think the problem of evil is not a good argument against God's existence. You know, there's nothing positive. So that's the argument is no good. It doesn't give you a positive argument the other way. So you've always got to make that distinction. Suppose there's an argument for God's existence from design. So one argument is like the human eyes are so well designed that God must have made them. Therefore God exists. And you might say, that's not a good argument, because what about evolution? But that doesn't show that God doesn't exist. It just shows that you haven't got... that's not a good reason to believe that God exists. Because there might be some other reason, maybe first cause or something, which is a reason for believing God exists. So you've always got to make that distinction. So So when you're, so I call this the zigzags. So if you, if I'm reading a student essay, and they just say, or any essay, or any, and they say, here's the conclusion and here's my reason for it, or maybe here's two reasons. That's a bit boring. Right, what you want to say is like, those are the reasons. Now someone might object. Someone might say, no, that's no good. For this other reason, so that's R3. And they might object to this reason, like that. I need another colour, really. But then I reply that this argument against my argument is no good, as follows. And this argument against that argument is no good. So this one, with the red in, gets a much higher mark. It's much less boring to read than one which just says, here's the reason for the conclusion. Here's the reason for the conclusion. But duh, she can block it. She can do that. So what then? No, I've got to have a reply to her argument against my argument. Okay, so that's the sort of way in which you could structure your essay. You could say, here's what I'm arguing for, say materialism or whatever view it is, or consequentialism. And I'm going to argue against the arguments against my arguments for it. Here are some arguments against it, and I'll argue against those. Conclusion. So that will give you, suppose that was how it went. So you're giving a reason for it, you're considering an objection, you're replying to the objection. Then you're thinking of objections to your view, and you're replying to those objections. So that gives you so you have an introduction saying what you believe, you have a conclusion, and that would give you five sections of your essay in a way that would make sense. So this is the reason, the positive reason. Here's the objection to the positive reason. You describe your opponents, and here's the reply to the positive, to the objection to your positive reason. Here's the reason, here's the negative reason, the reason against your view. Here's your reply to that negative reason, conclusion. So here we've got five parts. Mm-hmm. Now this is an animal. This is a walking, talking animal. This animal can do something in the world. This essay, I mean, it depends how well the details are, but this is something which makes sense in the way the whole structure makes sense. So, right. So that's how to go about thinking about it. The first thing you do is decide what you think. Then you're deciding how you're going to get there, and then the whole thing is structured around that goal. Okay, and that makes an interesting essay and a good one, but also a strong one. Like a coffee maker, it's going to be a really good cup of coffee. Because it's got fail-safe devices in it, you know, quite often. Like you make a machine and it has something built in for when something goes wrong. So you have a tray at the bottom for when too much liquid comes out. So your coffee maker is good, but sometimes there's going to be too much comes out, so you have a tray for spilling the extra coffee. That's like a reply to an objection. You've sort of built in a safety device there, which is good. That's a good machine. So anyway, let's throw some ideas about how to go about thinking of philosophy and writing in philosophy and pursuing dialectic. There's nothing yet. You have to begin with your view, your own view. You should never be afraid to have your own view, and it should be open. I hope you know your teachers allow you to say almost anything. You can have the craziest view you like. It doesn't matter as long as you can argue for it well. No, I never mark anyone down. Students sometimes find out what my views are, and they think I'm going to give them better marks because I agree. No, this is what I care about. Can they do the zigzag? Is this an interesting battle? Okay, any questions about all that? Primarily from students and also anyone else? How did you like our fight?
Actually, I want to ask, in China maybe it's only me, but I always write the writing just like doing the conclusion work.
Say that again. You do the writing like?
Just do the conclusion. Maybe some different people's view, and I combine that in the.
Yeah.
So
see,
I don't know if.
I think you might pass, but unless you give reasons for your conclusions, because philosophy is about reasons for conclusions as well as your view. You can't just give your view. Suppose I think you it's good to eat meat. I think, well, it's good to eat meat. I like eating meat. It's very tasty. It's good for health. But if you don't consider that some people think, well, poor animals, they suffer, what are you going to say about that? It's quite weak. So it's as if you're holding your view, you're standing like this, and you've got no defences. So it's a very fragile essay. So you can be pushed over like that, because... I don't do martial arts, but you know, I imagine if you just stand there like that, someone just pushes you and you fall over. So you've got to be like this, so you know when they're coming. Please.
How do you think about writing an essay literally in the form of a dialogue? I mean, nowadays they don't do it, at least if you do that, they normally don't accept a paper like that to have it.
It's very difficult to do that. But they should be sort of in the form of a dialogue. But actually writing...
Sometimes I found it's easier to do.
Yeah.
Because it's writing that way.
I mean...
But why don't they accept a paper like that?
Yeah. Well, there are one or two dialogues. John Perry wrote a beautiful one for students. I think it's... I mean, there is a question about why philosophy is produced in books and papers, and why not other methods. I think one of the troubles about a dialogue, you see, is the following. When I was in Durham, there was a very clever man in the classics department who did philosophy. And he wrote about Plato, and he was also interested in Persia and the connections in the ancient world between Persia and the ancient Greece, which is interesting. And he wrote about Plato, and I love Plato.
Professor Boystones?
Boystones? No, it wasn't. It's Hawking. But I know Boystones. Professor Hawking, young guy. And then one day he wrote a book about Aristotle, and I was shocked. So I said, why have you written a book? It was in Oxford, but he always did Plato before that. And I said, why have you written a book about Aristotle? You're a traitor. You're a traitor. Aristotle is... Plato is the great philosopher. Aristotle, he came later. He's all right, but he's a bit boring. I love Plato a lot. And it's not quite true about Aristotle, but I was joking with him. We met on the bridge, the big bridge, Albert Bridge. He said, after a while with Plato, who wrote dialogues, he got frustrated because you can never tell what Plato's view is. Plato is always playing a game with you and presenting the arguments, but you actually want to know what Plato thinks. And with Aristotle, he says, this is what I think. So in a way, writing a dialogue is very sophisticated, and you know, presumably when you're writing your essay, you're defending that, you know, materialism is true, or we can or cannot eat meat. It should be what you actually think. And so in a way, this is like a dialogue in that you imagine various actual or possible objections to your view, but it's always clear that you actually agree with this conclusion. But that's not the case with a dialogue, because you don't actually have to have, you can just present the arguments. Whereas it's really important, I think, that when, I mean, sometimes with students, what they do is, at the undergraduate level, not so much at the graduate student level, is they read everything and they sort of write about everything they've read, and they come to us and they sort of come to a conclusion, but it's not really what they think. It's really what they think they're supposed to think. So they're trying to work out sometimes what their professor wants them to say, and then they write what they think the correct answer is, which is what their professor wants. And then they write that, and they... and in a sense, from a student's point of view, that makes sense, because they want to get a good mark. But you can only get... You know, that's a way of getting a quite good mark. You can never get a very good mark like that. But I understand the motivation. But really, if you're reading that material, you should really think, do I really believe this? So if you, you know, you've got to be really... And the thing to do is, when you're writing your essay, is you get out all the books, you read all the books, you take notes, and then you should go for a walk. You should go for, don't talk to your friends, try to put your phone down. I know it's really difficult. Without your phone, leave your phone at home, and go for a walk around four streets. And work out what you actually think about the topic. But come back and then say, well, actually, I know my professor wants me to be a materialist, but I think dualism's right, Descartes' right, or something like that. Or I know my professor is crazily against eating meat, but I think it's a wonderful thing. Or I know my professor is a consequentialist, but I'm a Kantian. And I can tell, I know in the class, every time with that professor, it's clear that my professor wants me to believe that Kuhn has the right view of scientific revolutions, but I think scientific realism is correct, something like that. And then that's what you think, and if your professor gives you bad marks for that, it's so much the worse for your professor. But you will have learnt much more by actually deciding what you think for yourself. But I know there's an easy way. You just, well, what do they want me to say? I better write this. Is this very familiar to you for your psychology of writing essays? Does that make sense to you? I presume you're undergraduates. Is that familiar to you, or this thing of working out what your professors want you to say? And okay, any more questions?
I want to ask a question that before I write the paper, how I make sure that the question or the problem is significant, not a trivial, trivial problem to...
Yeah. Well, it probably isn't trivial, because otherwise you're... teachers wouldn't be talking about it. Some problems in philosophy are trivial, maybe, but it's unlikely. So I think I would assume that it's not trivial, unless you've got a good argument for the fact that it is trivial. But certainly that can be one way to go. You could say, there's this problem, and it's not a serious problem. So that's sometimes a way of going forward in philosophy, perhaps. But there's not really a method for deciding whether or not... well, I suppose the only way to work out if it's a real problem is to get very precise about what the problem is. So that's something I haven't talked about and I should have talked about. So you're discussing materialism. Right. What is it? So actually, he's a good example, perfect example. Many philosophers, not now, but in the 30s, they thought that the mind-body problem was trivial. It wasn't a serious problem. So I've read, actually, Schlick, Maurice Schlick, and also Wittgenstein thought this, that actually it wasn't a serious problem. And many people think you can't even, and in fact I'll talk about this next week in the first lecture, many people think you can't even describe what the mind-body problem is, because the notion of the physical, as opposed to the mental, these two categories are not well defined. What is the physical? You know, there's this problem, is it just contemporary physics, or is it future physics? If it's contemporary physics, materialism's probably false. If it's future physics, that could include anything. This is called Hempel's dilemma. So sometimes, so I have an answer for you, which is you think very carefully about the crucial terms, and it could be that they're very ambiguous. So that's one way to start thinking about whether an issue is the nature of an issue and if it is very serious. So sometimes there are issues which, if you're clearer about the terms and what they mean, then it would look very different. So this is when you get philosophers who say, well, I'm going to distinguish three different notions of blah, blah, blah. Necessity, the physical. So make distinctions. Making distinctions. Any other questions about this essay writing? Have you ever had a discussion like this before? I just wondered, is this totally unfamiliar kind of this? Have you ever had a professor do something like this with you?
I think they are not quite familiar, but I've ever taught some basic method of structure, but it's not so difficult. I think it's quite helpful for us.
Does that make sense to you?
I think when we read the classical articles, we always find such structure like in Descartes or in Kant. They are continental, but they write in this way. I think it's just a new thing that people don't write in this way. I mean,
that's
Kant.
That's true. I read some Kristeva once, or Derrida, and it just seems to have no structure. But I think maybe that's deliberate.
I think after Kant, there's a big change in the academic world of the continent. There's some amateurs like Hegel or other people coming to academic circle and change the writing style.
Yeah. Well, Hegel, yeah,
he's like amateur.
So maybe that's enough of that, and I'll go on to my topic for today.
Yeah, that'll be around.
Okay, right, let's finish with that. So you can ask me about that, or any students might want to ask me about that in the future. Okay, let me get to my first topic, and I'll go through it much more quickly. So this is about a priori knowledge. I just thought that might be useful for students.
What is the write the papers, maybe they should do it in this way. But when they come to the exam to do the exams, they also need to do in this way.
I think this is especially for exams, because exams you have to think very right there. You have to think, what do I think about this question? And if you, so I call it a microwave meal. So sometimes you're reading a student essay, and you know it's. We have a lot of Indian food in Britain. We like Indian food a lot, and you can get microwave Indian food, and you put it in the microwave and you reheat it. You can tell when you read it that they've just memorized things,
okay,
and they're writing it down. That's a bad. That's not, because usually they don't answer the questions.
So that means, for that exam, you can only do one or two questions. You cannot do many questions. Only one or two questions, because you have to. Right, such a long structure. So for each question, well, we have a long paper.
Well, You could, I mean, the exam has a certain length, and there's, you have to answer the same a number of questions.
Okay.
And you have to do the best you can within that time. I mean, you know, if you're talking about the mind-body problem, you can talk about 4 pages, 40 pages, 400 pages, 4,000 pages. It's the same, it's all too little. So you have to make, you have to be pragmatic about the length. So the shorter it is, you must be very concise.
Okay.
If you really understand something, you can explain it very clearly and in a very short time, in a few sentences. If you don't really understand something, it'll take you a day and then it still won't make any sense. If you really understand something, you can say, here's the problem, bang, one sentence. Or, and here's the main issue with this, 2 sentences. So you should always try and be very simple and concise, say everything in a very clear way.
How many essay questions you usually learn for certain exams?
Well, usually about 1 per hour, but sometimes 3 in 2 hours. So about usually that's in the UK, and I think in the United States as well.
So for 3 hours, you have to answer 3 key questions.
3 hours, they're usually 2 hours now, because it's too long.
Okay.
3 hours. It might be 3 in 2 hours, typical. But you can do, sometimes you do
shorter ones.
You could do shorter ones.
Okay.
So I was doing...
But you still have to provide the, you know, arguments.
Yeah.
The positive arguments.
It's always have structure.
The negative arguments, and then your argument against, you know, the negative arguments, and then come to conclusion.
It depends on the question. The question might be, is Searle's Chinese Room argument a good argument against functionalism?
Wow.
So you know the Chinese Room argument?
Yeah.
Famous argument.
Yeah.
So you might ask them to assess that argument.
Mm.
Well, then you're not looking for arguments in favor of functionalism. You're just assessing the argument against functionalism.
Mm-hmm.
So then it would be bad to discuss something that you were not asked.
Mm.
So it depends on the question. So you must read the question very carefully.
I think that, you know, in China, you know, when you write an MA thesis, maybe you are doing this thing.
Mm.
But usually, when you come to, when you come to the exam, you just give the answer to many questions, you know.
So they short answers, like one page.
Answers. So that's a test for the knowledge. It's not for the argument.
Knowledge.
Yeah. How much you learn from the classroom?
Oh yeah. Well, because sometimes, you know, you've got to know what Descartes or Kant said.
Yeah.
So suppose you think Descartes was a materialist.
Okay.
That's not good.
Oh. Yeah.
But so maybe you would get marks off. If you thought Descartes was a materialist, or if you thought Descartes was an atheist materialist, you think, what is this, you know? But actually, I would still be more interested in their arguments. You know, even if they got something really wrong, like that, I would be more interested in what their arguments were. So I think, this is the question of whether what we're teaching and what we're examining is knowledge or skills. And I think philosophy is more about skills than knowledge. I think that's the question. And I think if you just teach people knowledge, you end up with a situation like in Europe, where people study philosophy in high school for maybe 4 years, 5 years, and they don't really understand anything about it. It's as if a waste of time, really, in France. They study it in high school. Oh, yes, Plato. I can remember what they said. But they don't really understand that there are these positions and that there might be arguments either way. They don't really understand there are issues, philosophical issues. It's dead. It's completely dead.
Yeah.
And so
Yeah, we try to provide an argument in favor of against something you got to understand.
That's right, but also you must understand why Descartes wanted to say that. Why did he say that? Was he crazy? So you've also got to get inside the philosophy. So if you just give it back, memory.
Yeah, I just think we can all agree with you. I mean, the argument is much more important than knowledge.
Yeah,
but as a matter of fact, the sad fact is that in China, a typical philosophical question you're coming for is answering in an exam is like, what's Kant's view on freedom? Such a,
really?
That's typical.
Yeah, incredible. But it's not. You see, I would say, assess Kant's view on freedom. And then you'd have to know what it was and then engage in the philosophy. And you'd have to think about why Kant held that view.
Right.
So that way you have real understanding of Kant's view, whereas if you just describe it, yeah, okay.
I'm not quite agree with you. No, I'm playing the bad guy.
Yeah.
In the talking, I find the most people don't understand Descartes, but they criticize Descartes, especially by Kant. They don't understand, they criticize. And their argument, in fact, is the same argument like Kant. Although if he reads the history of philosophy, most of their argument had talked before.
Yes.
I don't mean we don't have to make arguments. We have to learn. Even they have tried. We have tried.
Yes.
Yeah. We don't learn the argument. We have to use the argument. We use. We learn argumentation. Yeah. I understand that.
Yes.
But I think it's we should pay some respect to the our pioneers.
I completely agree with this. And when I've taught history, I often teach Descartes' Meditations and Hume's Inquiry. Those are the two most recent things I've done. Descartes, year after year, I teach. And I usually give extra marks for someone who defends Descartes against modern objections. Because Descartes is actually so clever, and Hume also, that the objections are usually quite superficial. He's seen them coming. So, you know, he's done that and that and that 3 centuries ago, before some person in 1965 thought they had a clever argument. So I think that's absolutely right. So you have to respect the text and the author, but you have to read the author as it were, alive and as a contemporary. You read like a contemporary philosopher who's replying to these objections, who's holding views, and defending them as well against what you might think of the a good. So people very often think they've got very simple arguments against Descartes, and they're almost always not very good, I think. So I agree with that. You don't just historical figures are not there to be refuted.
I think the German model. Yes, I make an advertisement for it. It's maybe some good is they have two parts. One is the lectures. The professor, especially the older professor, makes lectures. They will explain what Descartes said, what Kant said, and also introduce some new controversy or the people who criticize Kant. And I would like to against they make an introduction. Then we have talking seminar. The young assistant, maybe the professor himself will come and raise questions, students answer, and the argument, and he objections, then,
This is so hierarchical. It's, I mean, the German system is exactly like this. The professor will say that, then the assistants. I mean, I'm more democratic, I think, about this. I think, you know, I mean, I went to a conference in Germany on aesthetics. It was in Frankfurt. And I couldn't believe the senior professors. They actually didn't know their Kant very well. They were supposed to be scholars, but actually for them it was all about authority. So I think philosophy, I mean I shouldn't say this, shall I? I'll get into trouble or the government will probably throw me out. But I mean I think there's something
from Germany. Yeah.
I think that there's something naturally anti-authoritarian about philosophy. Look at Socrates. He's the first philosopher, really. And he stayed away from power. And, of course, he got into trouble and was put to death. He was a very annoying person. But I think, you know, he's equally, in talking to a slave or a young man, as talking to Gorgias or Protagoras, famous German professors, you know, Herr Professor, Doctor, and that person, the question is, what have you got to say? How good is the argument? It doesn't matter what you, it shouldn't matter what your status is. This is, anyway, so this is very democratic and egalitarian.
German has a democratic part. The second part is talking. We just professor raise questions, student answer, professor objecting. It's democratic. They have two systems. And I would like to invite you to the seminar in the next week on Saturday and Sunday.
Okay.
A professor from Germany will give
lectures.
Maybe you have interesting.
Yeah, I suppose I haven't. I suppose I know about the German system from people who've come there and what people have said about it. It's very difficult to get a job in Germany. You have to, there's a hierarchy, and
yes.
You cannot, merit doesn't get you on. So I like a meritocratic system where, which made the Genghis Khan and also the Roman army was so strong as armies because you could begin as a slave and you could end up as general of the Roman army.
Wow.
And similarly with Genghis Khan, you were very, you know, he killed lots of people.
Genghis Khan.
Very, the system was very meritocratic. You could rise up the system if you were good as a soldier. But the German system doesn't allow that, you see.
Maybe
it's too much hierarchy.
We can let you and the German professor make a debate.
Yeah, we should have this debate.
Yeah, he will come in next week. You can have a debate.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, let me get on to the time.
Okay.
Because we won't have much time. So, empower and knowledge.
Maybe 5 minutes, Ray.
Do you want to, I don't know if you want to talk.
Yes.
I think let's just, are you all very tired after that?
Let me just go on the topic.
Empower and knowledge. So I have to do this very quickly now. I think that was worth doing, maybe. And I think what I'm thinking is that some students will remember this class in 5 years' time.
Only in 5 years'
time?
Probably in 50 years'
time.
50 years'
time.
Whole life.
Okay.
Awful.
Okay. So the a priori knowledge, it's a historical, historically an important issue. So you must be historically sensitive to people in the past who've thought about it, because they've usually been very clever, and usually probably much cleverer than us. But there's a problem about a priori knowledge, which is that when we come to think about some areas of thought, like mathematics, logic, morality, necessity, perhaps God, we have a problem because they do not seem to be knowable empirically, that is, through perception or causally interacting with the things around us. So the way we know things empirically seems straightforward, roughly, that the world impacts on me and I form my beliefs because of the things and the situations in the world through perception, and that's understandable. And then we have a problem where it seems that we have knowledge of some things which is not like that. And so it's typical to make this distinction between a priori knowledge and empirical knowledge. Although there are some people who think we don't have any a priori knowledge. It's not so common to say we don't have any empirical knowledge. That's not so common. But some empiricists, like Hume, like Quine in the 20th century, is the most radical, but also sort of like the logical positivists in the 1930s, are skeptical about a priori knowledge. So in the history of philosophy, there have always been people who've worried about it. So we want to try and understand that. So the reason, so what's the problem? So what I want to do today, setting up the structure, is describe I mean, I'm going to have to do it quite quickly, like a student, like a fast exam, is describe the problem. And then, relating to your question about, is that when we have to think quite carefully about what the problem is, and be really trying to be precise, because that helps us. So I want to describe the problem, and then having done that, in the second part, I'll look at some answers to the problem, which I know, and then I will argue against them. So like some of this, some of that, some of this, some of that, some of this, some of that. And in the last part, I'm just going to make some positive suggestions so that we're not too depressed, so we don't end up as radical empiricists. So what? So that's roughly how it's going to go. That's the structure. So that's what I was thinking about that. And yesterday I thought, maybe I'll talk about structure, and then I thought I'll talk about essay writing. Okay, so what's the problem? The problem is, roughly speaking, there are some kinds of reality, mathematics for example, which is radically disconnected from our mind or our knowledge of it, or our beliefs about it. We can't understand. It seems like there are these facts, and then there's us and the world we live in, and it's difficult to see how we make contact with this reality. But if we don't make contact with it, how do we know it? So the problem comes up in the philosophy of mathematics in the clearest way, and it's called the Banaserev problem, after a philosopher at Princeton who formulated it in 1973, I think, in a famous essay. So if you're a realist about mathematics, so you think there are mathematical entities, and why think that? Something we've talked about before. Because we quantify over them logically. We make claims like there are, or there is no largest prime number, or there are many prime numbers. We make these quantificational claims. It seems we're committed to these things, but mathematical objects are not in space and time. You cannot trip over. You know, the number two can't fall on your head. So it seems that they are abstract objects, they fall into a special class, and they're not physical, not in space and time.
So what are mathematics objects in the geometry?
Hang on a sec, let me finish this thought.
Okay.
So it seems that we have, we are in space and time, and we causally interact with things. I can causally interact with this. The mathematical objects are not. So we're cut off from the mathematical objects. Geometry might be different, but just stick with mathematical objects.
Yeah.
But then you might think, this is a problem in Plato, the perfect triangle, we could conceive of that, but that seems also like an abstract object.
Mm.
So it's maybe the same problem with geometry.
Yeah.
So the problem is that there's a general theory of knowledge people have where you've got to be, in order to know something besides belief and fact, there has to be some connection between the belief and the fact. The belief-fact connection. But then if we are in space and time, and abstract objects are outside of space and time, then what could this connection be such that we are responsive or sensitive to these facts? That's really the problem of the Banaserev problem, and it's also the problem of a priori knowledge, because everyone who's thought about it, many people believe in a priori knowledge, but no one thinks it's not a problem. Everyone thinks it's a problem. Okay, so so the thought here is you've got a general account of knowledge as something like responsiveness or sensitivity, and then you've got something like causation as making the difference between a priori and empirical. So this is a substantive claim. Not everyone agrees with this. But the idea is that empirical knowledge, what makes the distinction is when there's some kind of causal connection between belief and fact. Because if the fact causes my belief, then there is a connection. And then we can understand how we have knowledge. So you've got a fact, you've got the belief, and if the fact causes the belief, in many cases it's like that, then that's a kind of connection between belief and fact. So you can see how you can get knowledge because your belief is generated or caused by that fact. So that's supposed to be an account of a general account of empirical knowledge. You have to complicate it with knowledge of the future. So it's not so simple, because in knowledge of the future, so sometimes you have, here's the belief, and here's the fact, and you have a straightforward causal connection. But obviously, suppose I believe that the sun will rise tomorrow. That's not caused by that fact, but I can know that the sun will rise tomorrow, and that's because there can be an indirect causal relation between here's the fact in the future, and there could be other past facts. This is a future fact, and there can be a common cause. So there can be the causal relations can be direct. And they can be more complex, you know, they can take... But as long as there's a causal connection between the two, the thought is that you can show how, roughly, it's no accident that we get it right. But the idea is with knowledge we get it right, and it's no accident, and that's because of some connection between the belief and the fact. It doesn't have to be a straightforward causal connection. There's still a connection with the sun rising tomorrow. So my belief that the sun will rise tomorrow is caused by past experiences of the sun rising, knowledge of laws of nature, roughly. I put those two together and I infer that the sun will rise tomorrow. But there's an indirect connection of the future fact with my present belief about the future. So you slightly have to make it a bit more complicated. But the idea is that this causal thing is a criterion distinguishing a priori from empirical, because that's what you don't have. You don't have a story like that with abstract objects, because they don't cause anything. The number two, there's many things you can say about the number two, but it doesn't weigh anything. It can't hit you on the head. Okay. I'm going to have to go pretty fast over this. So what you're seeking is something which is quite fashionable in the philosophy of science, I've realized recently, is something like a mechanism connecting. There's got to be, there's your cognitive functions, your believings, and there's got to be some mechanism by which you lock on or are connected to facts of the relevant kind. And you need that mechanism to be there for knowledge. In the case of empirical knowledge, it's straightforward what it is, usually a matter of causation, perception, not very mysterious. In the case of other subject matters, it's mysterious. And that leads to a problem for a priori knowledge. So there has to be a problem. So one thing you want is to is not just to answer the question here. Sometimes you want to answer a question in philosophy, but sometimes you also want to describe the problem accurately so you can see why people are worried about it. So just to note that I haven't done it in terms of perceptual experience, because perceptual experiences involve the idea of causation, but they're more than that. But where you're perceptually sensitive to something, there is also a causal relation. if you make perception into the criterion for a priori knowledge, you will end up with a lot of self-knowledge will end up being categorized as a priori. But it seems like if I know that I intend to go to the gym tomorrow, that self-knowledge of my intention, what I'm intending to do tomorrow, or I'm intending to buy something from a shop, I'm intending to have breakfast tomorrow, that knowledge, it would be very unusual in the history of philosophy to categorize that as a priori. Okay, or even knowing, so suppose you have a perception, knowing that you have a perception. You're not perceiving your perception. It seems you have some kind of knowledge of your perception. But you might think that's a causal. I believe I'm having a perception because the perception causes my belief. So that turns out as empirical on a causal criterion, but not on a perceptual criterion. So this is a point which Colin McGinn makes. Okay, so there's roughly a problem there, which it's a very simple problem, that we and our believing is one thing and the facts are another, and so it's difficult to see how we get between them. So I make a comparison here with Descartes' problem over mind and body. You remember Descartes on mind and body? Which is that you've got two different substances. And then Queen Elizabeth objects to him. She says, Queen Elizabeth of Bohemia, she says, but if these substances are so different, how can they causally interact? How can there be any connection? And so how can you actually do anything in the world? So it's a bit like that problem, the problem of a priori knowledge, but even worse. Because at least the mind, the dualistic mind, the soul, is in space and time. Whereas the objects of mathematical and logical knowledge, perhaps geometrical knowledge, well, that's a slightly difficult case, they seem to be abstract objects, completely different in nature. Okay, so how do we... Let's look at some attempts to get round the problem and to solve the problem. So many people have tried to come up with a solution to the problem. So let's have a quick look at those. Which ones do I choose? I'll select some. Some people say, well, look, the mathematical truths are necessary. So you can't imagine the opposite of them. And therefore it makes no sense to talk about being sensitive to them. So a few people have argued this. I think David Lewis might have even said something like that about knowledge of possibility and necessity. But Hartree Field points out that many people think that God's existence is... If he exists, he's a necessary being. But that still doesn't mean that our knowledge of that necessary being is easy to understand. Of course, you can't say, if God didn't exist, or if 2 and 2 wasn't 4, what would we believe? Because some people think that you can't make counterfactuals with impossible antecedents. So you can't. It doesn't make any sense to say, what would we believe if 2 and 2 was not 4? But the question then is, we have many mathematical beliefs, right? Why is it no accident that we tend to have true ones rather than false ones? What's the explanation of that? So the explanatory question is not why do we have our beliefs? Because that's a psychological question. The question is, why do we have the beliefs we do, given that the facts are like that? It's why do we have the beliefs, but why is there a correlation between beliefs and facts? That's the difficult explanatory question. I'm not saying it's nothing to do with psychology, But that's a puzzle, and this appeal to necessity does not address that. Okay, that's one point. Another point is, someone in your department's doing this, I think, is reduction. You might say, well, mathematical knowledge is really logical knowledge. So this is called logicism. Or you might, some people want to reduce, I think Frank Jackson wants to reduce knowledge of morality to knowledge of conceptual truths. So there are different kind of reduction attempts where, because there are many a priori problems of a priori knowledge, there are many subject matters. So you might try and subsume one under another. But I think this is no good. In general, I mean, it might work in some cases. Maybe, maybe you can reduce. Suppose you can reduce mathematics to logic in the way that Frege and Russell wanted. Okay, well done. You've reduced mathematics to logic. Now we've got the problem, how do we know logic? So there's still a problem left. So it might be a good thing to do, but it doesn't ultimately answer the problem of a priori knowledge of mathematics to say it reduces to knowledge. You might then say, oh, well, there is no knowledge of logic, it's really rules of language or something like that. But then, in that case, there is no knowledge either, because it's not a factual discipline anymore. So another thing people do is they say, this was very popular at the end of the 20th century, and it was revisiting something in the logical positivists that Quine, many viewed as rejecting. But some people wanted to say, well, we have conceptual knowledge of logic and mathematics. So we want to say, how do we know what and means? Well, to know what and means, we have to grasp rules, and we engage in the right inferences when we deploy that. And all that and means is, or if then or not, all that those means is these rules about rules which are built into the concepts. I don't believe that, because I think that they have these rules because we're using these concepts. So I object to that anyway. But even so, suppose that having these concepts meant you had this knowledge. You still have to explain. You still have to explain how we grasp these concepts. There's still an explanatory problem. How is it that we can have these concepts of logic and mathematics? You can't say, oh, we have this knowledge. It's good, well, because we have these concepts. That can't be the end of an explanation, because you need to show how we have concepts that have this knowledge built into them. So that was very popular with people like Peacock, Paul Boghossian. They all fell for this. I think this was all a mistake. Quite popular. Another solution is Kant's solution, which is to say that to try and explain a priori knowledge by saying, well, we have a priori knowledge because it's presupposed by empirical knowledge. Something like that.
Presupposed by empirical knowledge.
So we couldn't have any empirical knowledge in the world unless we had a categorical structure. We have experience of the world, so you have a transcendental argument. We experience the world. That experience presupposes a priori knowledge and a priori concepts. Therefore, we have a priori knowledge. Well, I'm sympathetic to that categorical claim of Kant. I think perception is structured in the way that Kant thought, with a priori concepts. Unlike you, who tries to do without that. But I don't think, it's not ultimately satisfactory, because it just shows, what it shows is suppose you start off with the premise that we do have experience, and then you say, well, that presupposes a priori knowledge. That shows that we have a priori knowledge, perhaps. That, but it doesn't explain it. It doesn't show how it's possible. It shows that it's possible because it's actual. It doesn't explain how it's possible. We still need the mechanism. We still need a mechanism. So Kant, I think, he really gives up on the problem of a priori knowledge because he goes transcendental idealist, which means there's nothing really mind-independent to know. But what we're really looking for when we're looking for a priori knowledge is the transcendental realist solution, whereby we've got a mind-independent realm of fact and we have some way of getting it. And what Kant does is he really gives up on that. So I don't think that... So in a sense, the argument doesn't work from the presupposition of empirical knowledge. And it would only seem to work if you give up on the idea that there's something, a mind-independent subject matter that we're seeking to know. So that's Kant in 2 minutes. I'm sure the German professor would object if he was here. Okay. Okay, so that's a bunch of brief objections to a lot of things people have said about a priori knowledge. So my own view is it's a very, very deep problem, but I believe in a priori knowledge. So I'm a believer. So I'm to some extent, a rationalist. And to some extent, a Kantian. If Kant was a transcendental realist, then I would be a Kantian. Interestingly, just to put something in brackets about the history of philosophy, is I study a lot of Austrian philosophy. And Austrian philosophy is very... Austria has a very different philosophical tradition from Germany.
Yeah.
Austria is very realist, and that's why there's a lot of connection between Britain and Austria, with Wittgenstein and a lot of people, because we have a realist tradition, both of us. So Cambridge, England, Austria, and all the logical positivists, they all came to Britain and America. Part of the reason for this is actually political, because German idealism with Hegel was associated with the 1848 revolutions.
1848?
Yeah. A lot of the revolutionaries were inspired by Hegel's German idealism. Mm. So the Austrian government made it official government policy that if you worked for a university, you had to be realist.
Oh, really?
So, which I agree with. I agree with that. I would pass a similar law. But it wasn't very democratic. But they thought that German idealism was politically dangerous. So I think this is I think this is a very serious problem. But I believe in a priori knowledge. But the question is, how is it possible? If you believe in it, it's got to be possible somehow, but how? So I want to leave you with just some really, I'm throwing out some suggestions like this, which don't really work. I'm just throwing out something like this, because it's such a difficult problem. It's such a profound problem in the history of philosophy, going all the way from Plato, Aristotle, all the medievals, through the Renaissance, through the Enlightenment period, up until the 20th and 21st century, people have been struggling with this. So it's a really deep problem. No one really has an account of a priori knowledge. So I'm going to make a suggestion in the end here. I don't pretend that I'm, after all this time, suddenly Nick Zangwill, who is he? Is going to solve the problem that, Leibniz, Kant and Plato, obviously. But I want to show you that you shouldn't be too depressed about this, that You shouldn't. I don't think you have reason to believe that it's definitely not possible. So the idea here is, think of, now we go back to dependence. Think of Plato's forms. So there's a problem with Plato. So here we are on Earth. Then you've got the world of the forms up here. These are abstract objects. So this is a normal picture you have of Plato. Here are the forms up here in the sky, the form of the beautiful and the good, mm-hmm. of identity. And here we are on Earth, and we somehow grasp the forms. This is a picture you sometimes get with mathematical Platonism and Gödel. Here's Gödel here, and here he has these intuitions. What are they? So this picture of Plato is completely false. Now, this is not Plato. So if you've done the history of philosophy, you should know that this is completely wrong about Plato. Plato believes in dependence. He thinks that the forms, again back to this picture of dependence, the forms are prime reality, and then the material world is a superficial reality that depends on and is explained by the forms. So if you want to explain why something is hot, what explains that is the form of hotness. This is the Phaedo. I presume you all read Plato here, you've all read Plato. You have a dependence relation between one and the other. Well, if that's true, then you don't get this picture, you get a relation of dependence. But where you've got a relation of dependence, you don't necessarily have two distinct things. It's not the same relation as where you have, you know, you have two kinds of reality, and they are like mind and body in Descartes. Instead, one is dependent on the other. Here's another example. I'll finish quite soon. Take logic. So my own view is I'm a realist about logic. I think there are logical facts, and there were logical facts before human beings evolved. It was true. I'm a believer in the law of non-contradiction, so I'm against Graham Priest and biomaterialism. I think there are, you know, it can't be the case that both P and not P. So I think that was true a million years ago. I think it's nothing to do with the human mind, and so I reject all these kind of logical positivist views that it's something to do with rules of language. Come on, it's ridiculous. That's a really bad theory, surely. But the logical facts are everywhere. Everything is subject to the laws of logic. So you've got, here's the world, and here you've got the abstract objects, the mathematical objects, the sets, and the other abstract objects, and here you've got the material things, biological, chemical, psychological. They're all subject to logic. So logic covers everything in the world. Logic, the logical claims are the most general claims they are. This is an idea you have sometimes in Russell, sometimes in Frege. And you get it, sub-Austrians, maybe Bolzano, I'm not sure about Bolzano. Anyway, this is it's a realist view about logic. But that means everything is subject to logic, including your mind and your beliefs about logic. Okay, now that doesn't show how we know about logic, but it does show that you don't have this picture, instead you have something like this picture. So the logical facts cover everything, including us. But that means we are not metaphysically cut off from the facts we try to know. So that means there could be a mechanism connecting them if we are somehow sensitive to these very general facts. I'm going to finish that. So that's just an idea for explaining. This won't really work for mathematics, but it works for logic. It might work for God. So this is the picture with the forms. It's just like the contemporary picture, the medieval picture of God. God is basic.
So God is responsible for everything's existence, for the entire physical world and human beings. Right? And in human beings, there's this idea of God. So this is Descartes again, the potter's mark argument from the third meditation. So he is God, he creates the entire world, including human beings, and puts the idea of God in human beings. So this idea there of God stands in a dependence relation to God. Mm-hmm. But that means you don't have this picture. You have, it does mean you've got to think about this dependence relation. It just means that you should not be completely pessimistic about the possibility of there being a connection between the ideas that we have and the fundamental reality which we and everything else